It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
Oceanside Christopher is a Catholic credit union, and they care about the Catholic community on Long Island.
It's a community. You come here, you feel like you know everybody in here, you feel comfortable, and always get great service.
You don't get that feeling when you go somewhere else to a commercial bank or even another credit union for that matter.
You come in here, everybody knows your name. It's always a hassle-free environment, and it's just very enjoyable to do business here.
We love that we're always greeted by a smile. Everybody here is so nice. We love the hours, the local feel of it. It's just like being a part of home when we come here.
I love this place. It's because it's a natural place. I do my finances, but I also get to know my faith is being represented.
And when I use my Oceanside Christopher Visa card, a portion of my purchase goes to support Catholic parishes. Hello and welcome to Everyday Faith Live. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlorn, joined by Sister Mary Alice Peel. In Vatican News, Pope Francis spoke about his three-day trip to Turkey and said all governments need to respect religious freedom. He also said we need to strengthen ties between the Catholic and Orthodox Church. Here are Pope Francis' highlights from his recent trip.
The Pope's three-day trip to Turkey was relatively short but intense. The Pope's call for unity between Catholics and Orthodox was a major theme, as well as the need to engage in dialogue with Islam. When addressing the rise and violence of ISIS, the Pope said it is indeed lawful to stop such an unjust aggressor. And these are the words he used when addressing Turkey's president.
Nel ribadire che è lecito fermare l'aggressore ingiusto, sempre però nel rispetto del diritto internazionale, voglio anche ricordare che non si può affidare la risoluzione del problema alla sola risposta militare.
That same day, while speaking before a group of Muslim leaders, the Pope said religion should never be used as a tool for violence.
In qualità dei capi religiosi, abbiamo l'obbligo di denunciare tutte le violazioni della dignità e dei diritti umani.
Some moments were marked not by the Pope's words, but rather by his actions. The Pope visited the Blue Mosque in Istanbul, where he prayed with the city's Grand Mufti in silence. A few hours later, the Pope celebrated Mass in the city's Catholic cathedral. In his homily, he explained that the Holy Spirit must be the force that drives Christian unity.
Più ci lasceremo guidare con umiltà dallo Spirito del Signore, più supereremo le incomprensioni, le divisioni e le controversie. Saremo segno credibile di unità e di pace.
While visiting the Church of St. George in Istanbul, the Pope surprised the leader of Orthodox Christians, Bartholomew I, with this request.
Richiedo un favore di benedire me e la Chiesa di Roma.
The unity of the Catholic and Orthodox Church was a common theme throughout the Pope's visit. The leaders of both churches celebrated the feast day of Saint Andrew together.
Voglio assicurare a ciascuno di voi che per giungere alla meta sospirata della piena unità, la Chiesa Cattolica non intende imporre alcuna esigenza.
Afterwards, both religious leaders signed a joint statement in which they firmly condemned the violence that's affected parts of the Middle East. A violence that's forced more than a million people to flee to Turkey from countries like Syria and Iraq. In fact, the Pope made it a point to personally meet with them.
Ho desiderato questo incontro con voi. Io volevo recarmi lontano, ma non è stato possibile per trovare i rifugiati. Voi che provenite dalla Turchia, dalla Siria, dall'Iraq, da vari paesi del Medio Oriente e dell'Africa.
On his way back to Rome, the Pope held a press conference on the papal plane for about 45 minutes. There he explained how Muslim leaders can put an end to Islamophobia in the West.
Io ho detto al presidente, ma sarebbe bello che tutti I leader islamici, siano leader politici, leader religiosi, leader accademici, dicano chiaramente e condenino quello, no? Perché questo aiuterà alla maggioranza del popolo islamico a dire no, davvero, ma dalla bocca dei suoi leader, no?
One of the issues that has divided the Orthodox and Catholic Church is the so-called papal primacy, which the Orthodox reject.
E il primato, perché si deve continuare quella domanda che aveva fatto Giovanni Paolo II, aiutatemi a trovare una forma di primato che possiamo andare. E questo è quello che posso dirle.
This is the Pope's sixth apostolic trip. He's also the fourth pope to visit Turkey. Paul VI, John Paul II, and also Benedict XVI visited the country during their papacy.
Following the grand jury's decision not to indict police officer Darren Wilson for the shooting death of Michael Brown, thousands took to the streets of Ferguson, Missouri, and around the country to protest.
As alternating scenes of peaceful demonstrations and those of violence, fire, looting were broadcast, Ferguson's faith leaders repeatedly urged that the only way to move forward was to amplify the voices of peace. Joining us on the phone is Most Reverend Robert J. Carlson, Archbishop of St. Louis. Good morning, Archbishop. It's so good of you to be with us.
Good morning, and thanks for the invitation.
Archbishop, you have really led the way, I mean, in quite an exemplary way, calling your people to peace, calling your people to prayer at this very tumultuous time. Can you speak about that a little bit?
Sure. If you go back to the early days of the Pax Christi movement, all the way back to World War II, people came together to pray for peace. And as a matter of fact, I'm a co-founder of a religious community, the Messengers of Peace, and we spend every day in prayer for peace and serving the poor. So it wasn't that difficult to understand that the solution to the difficulties that we face is obviously to bring people together, but also to reject violence because it's empty. It doesn't create anything. And we have to focus on prayer.
I think you've had an army of people assisting you in this, too. It sounds like your priests, your religious, your dedicated lay people have just been right behind you in continuing to preach this message in action and in deed, huh?
Well, yes, the priests throughout the archdiocese have been invited to and have had masses for justice and peace. We've had prayer services up in the Ferguson area. A monthly one for people across the archdiocese, and then the parishes that we have there, Our Lady of Guadalupe and Mother Teresa of Calcutta, have had services every week praying for peace. And as a matter of fact, as the violence was starting in Ferguson, I was in one of the parish churches there praying with a group of people that came because they understand that prayer is the only way.
Wow.
Archbishop, I understand you spoke of inspiration from St. John Paul II, one of course, our 20th century preeminent figures of hope and peace. What can you tell us about that?
Well, you know, St. John Paul, back in, I think, 1979, was visiting, Ireland, if I'm not mistaken, and talked about violence. And what he said was, violence is unworthy of man. Violence is a lie. It's against the truth of our faith. And it was that quote, which is much longer, really, that I think is really the inspiration for how a church should respond. One of the things I did before the release of the grand jury report is I went to one of our Catholic high schools where many of the young people actually come from the Ferguson area. In fact, some even live in the apartment building where the young man was shot and killed. And we talked about a number of things. We talked about how false violence is. And as one young man said, this is our neighborhood. We don't want people to come in from the outside and burn it. This is where we shop. We're against it. And they said, Archbishop, when this is all over, we would like to have a procession to show young Catholics believe is the way to achieve the goals that we're after. Yes, we probably have to look at rules of engagement and training when we talk about police, but also we have to learn how to talk to each other, and we're actually going to institute that after Christmas in the archdiocese and high schools, where we bring people of different races together to talk about their experience of what's been going on, and to help our young people get to know each other better.
You know, Archbishop, I have to say, you've been using your Facebook page in a beautiful way. I mean, it's just amazing how in touch you are and how you're using that new media to reach out to people. It's really fantastic. You did speak in a video that I saw on your Facebook page the other day about longstanding tension. And I think that's something good for people to see, that this also has a context where there has been tension for a while, huh?
Well, St. Louis is a place where systemic racism has never really been adequately addressed. Mm-hmm. And while Ferguson is the flashpoint, I think we have to go back to the fact we've made all kinds of wonderful laws in the 1960s, but we never actually got to know each other. And because of that, I talked about the fact I think we all have to examine our own hearts to see if our heart is affected by racism, and I think the answer for most people is yes.
Mm-hmm. I think that's so true, Archbishop. I was talking to a woman, a black woman, who said here on Long Island that she had to teach her son how to react if he was stopped. So I think it's something that as a nation we really need to look at. And we're kind of thanking you for your leadership on this, because obviously you've just jumped right in and address the issue from, of course, our Catholic perspective.
Well, you know, the elements are really, in one sense, simple, and in another sense, very complex. Obviously, prayer, but also mm-hmm. mutual understanding. And then the hardest one, I think, for most of us, is forgiveness. Mm-hmm. All three have to be there. Mm-hmm.
And I think you teach us a great lesson there, even for we who are in the New York area right now, dealing with the Eric Garner decision here in our own state and in the tri-state area. We're seeing protests that, thanks be to God, are overwhelmingly peaceful at this point. But nonetheless, there is tension everywhere. And I guess you've said that a few times. This really becomes a national issue, doesn't it?
It does. It is a national issue.
Yeah.
And we have to have response, I think, at the federal level, at the state level, at the local level. Mm-hmm. And there's several different audiences here. I mean, we have the people who are fearful mm-hmm. because they're black. Mm-hmm. And we have to be able to deal with that. Mm-hmm. And we have to seek their forgiveness. And they have to forgive us as well. But we also have the police community, and we have to deal with that as well. You know, their families are suffering, too.
Sure.
So it's a very, very complex issue. Mm-hmm.
I want to thank you for taking time to be with us, though, because I think in so many ways you're leading the country. I'm always sorry that I don't see you on any of the big news programs, you know, on television. And I said to our staff here, we really have to have him on so he can tell the story to the viewers who are watching, you know, across the country. So thanks so much for taking the time to be here with us.
Happy to be with you.
And we'll keep you in our prayers.
Yeah, blessed Advent.
God bless. Same to you. Thank you very much. Really very
inspirational.
Wonderful,
yes.
Yeah.
Pope Francis and religious leaders from Jewish, Muslim, Hindu, and other faiths came together at the Vatican earlier this week to call for an end to slavery by 2020.
It's estimated that over 36 million people around the globe live under some type of slavery, usually forced prostitution or forced labor. And so, religious leaders of different faiths came together in the Vatican to join forces to stop it. In fact, they set a symbolic deadline of 6 years to see significant results.
Declaramos en nombre de todos y cada uno de nuestros credos que la esclavitud moderna, en términos de tratas de personas, trabajo forzado, prostitución, explotación de órganos, es un crimen de lesa humanidad. Sus víctimas son de toda condición, pero las más veces se hallan entre los más pobres y vulnerables de nuestros hermanos y hermanas.
At a time when faiths are seen wrongly as a cause of conflict, It is a sign of real hope that today global faith leaders have together committed themselves publicly to the battle to end modern slavery.
When we have more clarity in our mind, we will have compassion not only for the victims, but for the trafficker themselves. When we see that the trafficker have suffered, we can help them to wake up and stop what they are doing. Our compassion can help transform them into friends and allies for our cause.
Me sumo a todos ustedes, desde mi condición de judío, elevando mi clamor con todas mis fuerzas, a fin que todo tipo de esclavización sea condenada en los términos y con las penas más severas.
Among those in attendance was an Indian woman named Mata Aritand Andan Amayi, who in Hinduism is considered to be a holy living person. There was also a Muslim representative of the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, which is the most important Islamic university. The leader of the Orthodox Church, Bartholomew, sent a video message as a sign of support. Two victims who survived human trafficking read a statement which was later signed by religious leaders.
We, the undersigned, are gathered here today for a historical initiative to inspire spiritual and practical action by all global faith.
The joint meeting was launched by the Global Freedom Network. It came about after the head of the Anglican Church, Justin Welby, shared the idea with Pope Francis back in March 2014. And religious leaders of different faiths joined in to not only make a statement, but to take action together.
Very inspirational. The Holy Father has this unbelievable ability to bring people together and to allow them to talk and to be together and to unite, huh?
And he's showing how important some of these issues are to the whole world. And so by bringing these religious leaders together, it's not just a Catholic issue. It's an issue for the international leadership. And he's so good at bringing them all together.
And Rome has this central kind of location now, which is amazing because it's becoming the place where people gather, right? That's a very important thing.
The United Nations,
exactly,
perhaps, right?
It's absolutely,
yes,
incredible.
But that this was about trafficking, too, was very important because, mm-hmm, that issue, we can't let that die.
Exactly.
It really is a 21st century issue that needs to be kept on the front burner.
Well, in the midst of all this, the secularization of Christmas has arrived once again. A billboard released by an atheist group says, "Dear Santa, all I want for Christmas is to skip church. I'm too old for fairy tales." The billboard, unfortunately, will appear in Memphis, Nashville, Milwaukee, St. Louis, and Arkansas.
According to a Pew poll on belief, many of the states targeted by the campaign have a smaller than average percentage of people who responded that they do not believe in God. Overall, American attitudes toward atheists are not positive. In a poll earlier this year, a majority of Americans said that a belief in God is necessary for individual morality.
Now, you know, out in the front of our rectory, we have a big sign, "Keep Christ and Christmas." Outside of these studios, we have a big sign, "Keep Christ and Christmas." And that's a way, I think, to, if you will, combat this kind of secularization. I think we have to be the people who take that stand, you know?
We have to recognize that those symbols of Christmas that are ours are so important that we let the world see them. We don't keep them behind closed doors.
Sure.
And we say Merry Christmas.
And this was a week, you know,
holiday,
on television, secular television, on all the networks. You saw Frosty, you saw Rudolph, you saw Charlie Brown. All well and good. But the reality, all of that celebrating, all of that tradition, at the root of that is Jesus Christ made man. That's the great gift. So that's why I think it's important for us to combat this really head on. You know, it's an important thing. So Merry Christmas in advance. We have to take a quick break. We have more EFL right after this.
Can't buy a best friend. You can love them, pet them, care for them, whether they want you to or not. You can take a picture or 50. You can bring them with you wherever you go. You can jump, yell, hide and go seek, play dress up, or not, go for a walk, or not. You can fly to the moon, travel the world, or just stay in bed. You can't buy a best friend like that. But you can adopt one. 'Cause we're connected. Ooh. We're
connected. Ooh.
In an interview with an Italian paper published earlier this week, Cardinal Angelo Scola of Milan stated that Pope Francis will not push the church away from the understanding of marriage's indissolubility. Cardinal Scola said during the synod he discussed the matter with some colleagues about the possible access to communion for the divorced and remarried, but said he cannot see how to combine on one side the indissolubility of marriage and on the other seeming to deny de facto the same principle.
Cardinal Scola went on to say, the Pope will not likely take any stance that he himself would not share, that is, one not in accord with the Church's tradition. He emphasized that the majority of Synod Fathers supported the indissolubility of marriage. He concluded by saying, Pope Francis' style requires humility of all of us, that we listen to him and receive his perspective.
Now, the indissolubility of marriage, in all honesty, was never really an agenda item, per se. It was really more the pastoral application of divorced and married, remarried Catholics, right?
That's correct.
Yeah.
And I think, unfortunately, the media picked up on certain elements of this, suggesting that the Pope was going to reimagine marriage. And people, of course, are very upset by that.
Sure.
That's not the issue. This Pope is very traditional in his theology. It's his pastoral practice that has him asking questions of how can we assist these people in these situations. And that's where the synod is going, that we have to learn to be more pastoral. The laws are very important to us.
Sure.
And we're not undoing them.
No, no, not at all. Right. It's about that pastoral application mm-hmm. that's so important. A life-affirming online ad campaign seeks to present the positive experience of adoption as an alternative to abortion for women facing unexpected pregnancies.
Last year, I got pregnant, but I was not ready to raise a child. I thought about letting my aunt raise her like she did my cousin's baby, but then I learned there were adoption agencies that would let me pick the family who would raise her and love her forever. A counselor even laid out the steps so I could finish school. I know I made the right decision for me and my baby.
Joining us now on the phone is Joe Young, Executive Director of Operations and Strategic Initiatives for Heroic Media. Good morning, Joe.
Good morning. How are you this morning?
Well, we're well here. Perhaps you could tell us something about Heroic Media.
Sure. Heroic Media is an organization, a 501c3 nonprofit that works exclusively in the pro-life area. We do three things. We do call for help to reach women who are facing an unintended pregnancy or an unplanned pregnancy and connecting them to local help through pregnancy centers. We also do attitude change media that is designed to impact attitudes around the culture of life. And the third thing we do is adoption. We promote adoption as a realistic and viable option for women facing unplanned pregnancies.
It's wonderful. So what you're using actually, I guess, as your primary vehicle is YouTube and various like Facebook outlet kind of things?
Well, we actually are a full scope media organization. We use
Beautiful.
Television. That ad that you just played is actually designed for television as well.
Good.
We do use the internet. So we use television, internet, billboards, mass transit, and print advertising to promote the pro-life and culture of life issues.
What a great thing. That's terrific. How did it all get started, Joe?
Well, we got started because our founder 10 years ago saw that the media impacts culture. And we knew that we could use the power of media to impact a pro-life perspective. So for the last 10 years, we started as an organization that primarily served Texas, and now we serve the entire United States and Latin America. working through our sister organization we planted in Latin America called Acciones Heroicas. But primarily, that's the way it got started. We just started looking at partnerships with pregnancy centers, national pro-life groups. You know, many of these groups are very good at serving women and serving their mission, but they didn't have the expertise to really get their message out through the media. And we decided that we would build a team, and we've built a world-class team here in Austin, Texas, and in Dallas, Texas, where our two principal offices are, and we have harness the power of mass media for the pro-life movement and message.
This is a great gift that you've given us. Now, you say that then you would partner with local organizations that would care for the women and that would do follow-ups and so on. Is that correct?
That is absolutely true. We work with, for example, in adoption, we've worked with the Gladney Center for Adoption, and we've worked with Bethany Christian Services, but we've also worked with Catholic charities in different dioceses across the country that promote their organizations. On our call for help side, we work with local pregnancy centers and maternity homes so that the clients or the women and men that we reach have a local place to them where they can get the services that they need to make life a realistic choice for them.
Jose, some people want to think about partnering with you. Right now we're on in about, 26 or 27 states. Can they contact you via your website?
Absolutely. www.heroicmedia.org. They'll be able to see some of the television commercials, including the one you just played about our latest adoption commercial. There is another one up there as well. They can find out more information about us, and if they want more information, they can just shoot an email to info@heroicmedia.org, and we'll get that and respond back to them.
Thank you so much, Joe Young, for being with us. It's taking a beautiful stance for life and joining forces together. We become very strong. So thank you so much for what you're doing.
Thank you guys very much. You know, that it's absolutely true. We're much stronger united than we ever are working individually.
Without a doubt. And we'll be playing your ad on our network. I promise you that.
Thank you, guys. Have a great day.
God bless you, too. Right now, of course, in our Catholic Church, Advent is our liturgical season. We're in the second Sunday of Advent. It's a period, of course, of preparation extending over four Sundays before Christmas. And it's very joyous and beautiful season. I love the readings. I'm a little biased, but I just love preaching on these readings throughout Advent. Huh?
Well, you do a good job on it, too. and I think what happens to us in this very hectic time is that our daily readings help us to slow down and helps us to prepare for the fact that it's all about Christ's birth. And that's why we have this season. And so I just love them too. And the whole idea that we have 4 weeks to wait, you know, in joyful expectation. Those words are beautiful.
Important.
Waiting in joyful expectation.
Now, for those of you who are on Long Island in the Diocese of Rockville Center, we're going to have Advent Lessons and Carols this Sunday, December 7th at 3:30 from St. Agnes Cathedral in Rockville Center. Now, we're going to tape that and bring it to you all via the Telecare Network beginning on Saturday, December 13th at 4:30 and Sunday, December 14th at 8:30. And then you can check our website, telecaretv.org, for additional air times.
St. Joseph Hospital celebrated its annual Christmas celebration, where the staff creates a free magical wonderland in front of the hospital. Santa and Mrs. Claus, along with a team of elves and reindeer, and even the Grinch, read and hand out candy to young children.
That is not Sister Mary Alice and I in that video of Santa and Mrs. Claus, by the way. Somebody said that before we started today.
That's great.
But important to get together and to celebrate and to, again, utilize some of those traditions that are in secular society in this beautiful time of the year, right?
And to witness them right on Hempstead Turnpike.
Think
about
that, right?
Which is a wonderful thing to do.
St. Joseph's Hospital is quite exemplary.
There they are, and this is who we are.
Great organization. Yes. Great hospital, too. Well, thanks for being with us, everybody. For Sister Mary Alice Peel, I'm Monsignor Jim Vlorn. We will see you here at the same time next week. From all of us at Telecare, remember, keep the everyday faith live. Have a great week, everybody, and God bless. It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
I chose Oceanside Christopher because not only do they have, you know, the best interest for me as a member in mind, but just they're always people helping people.
I saw firsthand during Sandy how we took care of our members.
I was one of the flood victims, and at that time when it happened, I gave up hope.
We're very grateful that we have our faith in the church, and we also have our faith in the credit union.